When I finished university, I left my home country to start working in tourism. I traveled the world for about 7 years, and somewhere along the way, I learned languages. I fell in love, so I learned Spanish. I learned French and German because those were the languages that I needed for my job. And I improved my English because that was the language that I needed for international communication. Now, when I quit that job in tourism, people started asking me if I could help them to learn French or German or Spanish. And that is when I realized that knowing a language does not necessarily give you the knowledge to teach that language. So I started studying again. I started by studying a master's degree in applied linguistics to teaching English as a foreign language. But that did not give me the knowledge that I was looking for. I was eager to find out why something that comes easy and natural to me, like language learning, is complicated for others. I wanted to know a little bit more about how the brain works and be able to help people. So I continued studying. I became a certified neurolanguage coach, went on to become a life coach, and I recently finished a master's degree in educational neuroscience. Now, educational neuroscience sounds like a very complicated discipline, and there is certainly a lot to be learned. But I like to describe it as common sense in education explained by science. Educational neuroscience is where psychology, neuroscience, and education come together, and that knowledge is used to improve teaching and learning. What exactly is it that makes learning stick? And how can we help to make learning stick? One thing we know is that there is no learning without emotion. We need emotion to acquire new knowledge. We need emotion to retain that new knowledge. We need emotions for thinking, for problem solving, and we need emotions for focused attention. Let's try this. May I ask you to close your eyes? Close your eyes and picture a happy moment. Maybe you were at the beach last week with some friends. Maybe you are going further back. Maybe you are thinking about your first boyfriend, girlfriend, your first kiss, maybe. Feel free to choose any happy memory that comes to mind. Now, I would like you to remember as many details as possible. Where were you? Who were you with? What were you wearing? And what was the weather like that day? Was it hot? Was it cold? Was it a windy day? What can you smell? And how does this make you feel? I'm sure that you can all remember many details. You may open your eyes now. I'm sure you can all remember many details. And why is that? Well, our brains remember emotionally charged events better than boring ones. And although science is still a bit foggy on the details, we now know that positive emotions are related to our association memory. So if we apply that knowledge to the classroom, then we know that we need a creative, brain-friendly, and positive classroom atmosphere for learning to take place. So how can we help generate this much-needed positive attitude towards learning? Motivated students have a positive attitude towards learning. There are two different types of motivation. Students may be extrinsically or intrinsically motivated. Now, the extrinsic motivation will disappear once the student obtains the prize that was promised upon passing an exam, for example. The type of motivation that we are looking for is the intrinsic motivation. We need to stimulate and foster that motivation that comes from within. We need students to take ownership of their learning. As educators, we can offer the knowledge, but we cannot open the students' heads, put the knowledge inside, and then close the lid again. Wouldn't that be easy? Students themselves are responsible for that. So how come many students are reluctant to take on that responsibility? Could it be the fear of failure? The fear of making mistakes? We don't like to make mistakes. We do not like to be seen as stupid. We all feel the need to protect our egos. And that is why it is so important that the classroom is a safe place that allows for mistakes to be made and for questions to be asked. Remember that nobody was born knowing it all. Nobody was born knowing how to ride a bike. You get on your bike, you fall down, you scratch your knee, you bump your head, you get back on your bike again, and you give it another try. That is what the learning experience is all about. It is only by trying and getting it wrong the first time that you will then try again and maybe get it right the second or the third time. Now, it is equally important for us to look upon our own behavior. Are we motivated? Do we allow ourselves to make mistakes? Do we ask questions? Do we accept feedback? Recent research in neuroscience tells us that our emotions are contagious. Our brains are social organs. When we witness intense emotions, then we will feel those emotions as if they were our own. Now that gives us a responsibility. As educators, when we are passionate about our subject, we need to share that passion, we need to show that passion, because nobody enjoys listening to a speaker that seems to be bored with his or her own subject. Our mirror neurons are responsible for the empathy and the happiness that we feel when we see another individual experiencing those same feelings. Now, there's a much easier way to say this. What you give is what you get. Just give it a try and smile, and you will see that your smiling face will mostly be responded with a smile. Now, it is my opinion that the basic knowledge of educational neuroscience should be known by everyone. There's no need for all of us to become neuroscientists, but I do believe that this basic knowledge of how the brain works should be a part of primary, secondary, and university education. And it should most certainly be included in teacher training programs. Now, educational neuroscience is not a magical pill that will solve all problems in education, but it will help us to find some solutions. Because it is only by sharing the knowledge that we will stimulate an evolution in education. We share this knowledge with students, parents, teachers, and education specialists. And that way, we are all a part of this natural evolution in education. Now, if you feel the same way, then I would like to invite you to start reading, to start investigating about this fascinating new approach to education. Embrace the idea, share the knowledge, spread the word, and between all of us, we can make this happen. The future of education is bright. Thank you.